When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, he was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and I put my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet still come to believe." This is the gospel of our Lord. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hear the good news. Jesus, our Messiah, our hope, our reconciliation, was dead, and God has made him alive again. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
I have to say it like you mean it. God has done a new thing out of love for the world. God has come close to live among us, to bear the pain of being human in a broken world, to unlock the door to the kingdom of heaven now and forevermore. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. There you go. Alleluia. Amen. One Palm Sunday, little Cindy was all dressed to go to church, and she wasn't feeling well, and her mom took her temperature, and sure enough, she was running a high fever. So she told little Cindy, "You're going to have to stay home today." And off went her siblings with their dad off to church. She was not happy about this. They were laughing and joking as they went out the door, and she was stuck in bed. A few hours later, they returned carrying palm branches. "What are those for?" she asked her brother. "We held them high up over Jesus as he walked by," said her brother. "No fair," said little Cindy. "The one Sunday I'm sick and Jesus shows up." This must be a little how the disciple Thomas felt in today's scripture. He hadn't been at the tomb with Mary when Jesus spoke her name. He hadn't been on the road to Emmaus when Jesus walked with two of the other disciples. He hadn't been in the upper room when Jesus appeared to literally every other disciple except him. Literally, every other disciple. It was no fair. A few months ago at a Cub Scout meeting, a small girl who attends here played the most excellent practical joke on me ever to be played. It was perfect, especially because it was completely unintentional. The scouts at the end of the meetings, they stack all the chairs back on the long tables in the basement at St. Mary's. And so we were busy stacking chairs. And suddenly, one of the boys came up and said, "I have a few questions about some requirements I need to check off." So I pulled down a chair for him and a chair for me. And I turned around And I sat down, and there was no chair. I sat all the way down to the floor. My chair had silently and mysteriously disappeared into thin air. A girl of about, I think she was four then. Was she four? She had whisked my chair away, noticing that we were all cleaning up the chairs. And so I had a sore backside, but a very long laugh. It was actually a very impressive joke. And I was thinking about that and about Thomas. Brandon was telling me that today is often called Holy Humor Sunday, and you're supposed to tell a lot of jokes. And I wasn't really feeling it. It seemed like a lot of work. But I was thinking, you know, Thomas, he's sort of anticipating this huge practical joke. What if my friends are mistaken? What if I open my heart to believe Jesus is back, but it turns out not to be true? And I understand Thomas's protectiveness in that moment, to not want to be the brunt of a terrible practical joke. Because if Jesus is not back, then he's going to have a lot worse than a sore backside. His heart will be shattered. And so Thomas's response is human and raw and very real. He says, "Unless I see the nail marks in the hands and put my finger where the nails were, I won't believe." There are five stages of grief. The first stage is denial. And Thomas is firmly rooted there. If you look up denial and stages of grief, there are other words for denial. Wounded, in shock, numb, without hope. Thomas is wounded. Thomas is in shock. Thomas is numb. He is without hope. Unless I see the nail marks and I put my finger in them, I could never believe what you say is true. Well, little Cindy, the following week on Easter, she was walking home with her dad, and her dad asked her, "What did you learn today?" "Nothing," little Cindy replied. "Well, didn't you learn about Jesus?" her father asked. "No," said Cindy, "he wasn't even there today." Poor Cindy. I think about all the times where I've missed out on something, and I come back and I'm missing a critical piece of information, and I want to be part of the group, but I'm just not there yet. It might be a piece of my own brokenness, some healing I still need to recover. And that the disciples are there telling him the good news, but the disciples aren't the ones who can heal him. Only Jesus can heal his doubt. And so this week I've been thinking about how I am in my life all too familiar with doubt. It plagues me all the time. Did I cook the steak long enough or too long? That's the question I usually ask my husband, and he always tells me I cooked it too long. Did we do enough schoolwork today to count, to meet all the requirements we need to do? My son always says, "Yes, absolutely," and my heart always says, "Oh, we should do more worksheets." Are we going in the direction that we need to be as a family? There are all these little questions. Did I choose the right color carpet? Are these shoes going to last until next year, right? I have doubt about so many things in life. And so Thomas's doubt really doesn't surprise me because it's such a constant part of being human, that we have such limited knowledge. And I feel like I have been in Thomas's position. I have failed to believe in God's promises for me. I have been without hope in my ability to earn them. I have recognized in myself that I don't have the ability to earn God's promise. And I see that in Thomas. I have been numb to the grace of God. I have been told that grace is there, and I have been in places in my life where my heart is numb and I cannot receive it. I have been wounded deeply and lived in dark nights of despair. I have been shocked at the cruelty of the world and asked God desperately to show up in some visible, tangible way so that I would know it was all going to get better. Wounded, in shock, numb, without hope. Those words, those are the reason that Jesus came to this world. Because our hearts are rooted there, we get wounded how many times a day? We are in shock at this world and its cruelty. We get numb, not sure how to receive the grace God has offered. And we are sometimes without hope. That's why I have been and will continue to be in a conversation with doubt through my whole life. And at the same time as that conversation goes on in my heart, I stand and I cry out, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. I cry out in faith because stronger than my doubt is Christ's response to my doubt. When Jesus appears to Thomas, he doesn't come reprimanding and teaching lofty ideas or parsing words or debating politics. Jesus says, peace be with you. And he holds out his hands that are broken and he gives them to Thomas and he says, here, put your finger on my hand. Reach out and put your hand in my side. That's the first step. In this part, I see Jesus' words gentle and full of compassion. It's okay, Thomas. Let your doubt be quieted. Let your fear fall away. Look, I am here. I am wounded, and I am here, and I am risen for you. Then Jesus says, stop doubting and believe. And in these words, I hear the challenge of my faith community always urging me on towards healing. I don't hear an angry God saying, you should never doubt. I hear an invitation that there is a possibility that you could let go of your doubt and just believe, and you could come on this journey with me without fear. There's challenge for me not to settle into despair, but always keep moving forward, one Sunday at a time, one peace be with you at a time, one handshake at a time, one act of kindness at a time, one moment of bravery at a time. I cry out in faith because my Savior is wounded, just like me. He holds his wounds visibly and without shame, to bring healing to his disciples and to me. I affirm in faith that Jesus is risen because Jesus doesn't ever dismiss my shock at the devastating brokenness of the world. He simply holds out his hands to me and embodies the mystery that our brokenness is not the end of the story. He offers me a glimpse of healing and wholeness. I cry out in faith because the Messiah doesn't allow me to stay numb to God's grace. He rips off his bandages and wakes me up to a grace that is unstoppable, that is unpredictable, and that nobody can control except God. I declare in faith that my Lord is a risen Lord because my Lord and my God has hope for Thomas. Jesus makes an extra trip just for Thomas so that he can see and believe and be set free from his doubt. That must mean that my Lord and my God has some hope for me too. And like Richard reminded us, we're not doing this alone. That's why we come, to remind each other that the doubt is present and the love is stronger. May we be in our lives honest enough to have doubt and brave enough to believe in God's promises. This is the word of the Lord for today. Amen. Amen.